Thank you, Senator Seward. Senator Paterson.
Thank you, Deputy President. I've had the privilege of contributing to this debate a number of times in this chamber, so I will not go over too much old ground today. I won't go over the arguments about the importance of freedom of speech. I won't go over the evidence that the administration of 18C by the Human Rights Commission has been incredibly flawed. I won't go over the recent cases which show the harmful impact this law has had on journalists, cartoonists and students. There are two things I want to do today. The first is to respond to an argument made by Senator Seward, which has become a bit of a catch cry of those who propose to change to 18C. They like to ask, what is it that you would like to say that you cannot say under this law that you would be able to say if the law changes? It's a question they ask often. It's a question that they assert is not answered and has not been answered. But the only way they could have that view is if they haven't been actually listening to those who have a different view in this debate, if they haven't been following the Human Rights Committee's work on this issue, and if they haven't been following the debate closely. Because this question has been answered, and I'm happy to answer it today. It's a question that Senator McKim asked at the Human Rights Committee hearings, which we very much enjoyed participating in together around Australia. And he asked it at every hearing that I attended, except one. That was the Brisbane hearings, and Senator McKim was not able to be in Brisbane for the Brisbane hearings. And that was a shame, because there was a witness at the Brisbane hearings who had a very good answer to that question. His name's Alex Wood. He's a former student at the Queensland University of Technology, and he was one of the respondents in the QUT case. Alex had heard that this question was being asked, including in the hearings, and so he came prepared to answer it. Unfortunately, he wasn't asked it by Senator McKim, as he wasn't able to be there, but he was asked it and he did answer it. He said the thing that he would like to say that he is not able to say under the current law is that his university, QUT, is, quote, stopping segregation with segregation. That is, in fact, what Alex Wood did say on Facebook on the day that he was kicked out of an unsigned Indigenous computer lab at his university. And it took him 3.5 years and a torturous legal process which has disrupted his life, had a severe financial impact on him and his family and the other people involved in this case, potentially damaged his career. And we finally established after this torturous 3.5 year process that in fact Alex could legally say that, but not without going through that process. So there, if there are those that argue that we should not be able to say that, well then fair enough. But I think it is very difficult to argue that it is fair or necessary that someone like Alex Wood should have to go through that process to establish that he should be able to say that. The main purpose of my contribution to the debate today is to address one issue that I haven't specifically addressed in detail in this debate so far. And that is the argument that those in favour of changing 18C, such as myself, fit certain demographic attributes. It has been pointed out that some of us who are advocates of change of 18C are white. It has also been pointed out that some of us are men, and it has also been pointed out that we are men of a certain age. I think I may fail to qualify on that final category, but I certainly qualify on the former two categories. And it is said because we are white men of a certain age that we haven't experienced discrimination and therefore we should be much more careful in advocating this change. And it's something I've considered carefully, and I have two ways in which I'd like to respond to that. The first is that freedom of speech is a right for every Australian, and every Australian has an equal right to participate in the debate about free speech and to advocate for their point of view sincerely on free speech. Your gender, your race, your age has no bearing on your right as an Australian citizen to participate freely in public debate. The second thing I would say, though, is that a corollary of this argument is that is the statement which is often made that ethnic communities are united in opposition to changing this law. And it is certainly true, and we heard during the committee process, that many of the peak bodies which represent ethnic communities are opposed and are concerned about changes to this law. But I believe it's incredibly patronising and condescending to not realise that there is active debate within many ethnic communities, as there are in every community on every public policy issue, and there is a great diversity of opinion within ethnic communities on the desirability of change to 18C. And I believe those who are saying that ethnic communities are united and monolithic in opposition to this have either not been paying attention and haven't been listening to the ethnic voices who are in favour of change, or who have decided to ignore those voices because they are inconvenient for their arguments. And either way, I think that's wrong and doesn't do these advocates of change justice, and that's one thing I'd like to correct today by taking the opportunity to read into Hansard some of those people who have experienced discrimination in their lives, have been on the receiving end of racism, but nevertheless strongly and passionately support freedom of speech and strongly support the case for change in this law. The first is a gentleman by the name of Gideon Rosner. In the interest of full disclosure, he's an employee of my former employer, the Institute of Public Affairs, and a friend. He's also a Jewish man, and he wrote in the Herald Sun in December 2016, "Many Jewish Australians, myself included, share the same concerns about 18C as an increasing number of people in the wider community. Specifically, that banning forms of expression merely because they are insulting or offensive is inherently incompatible with the right to free speech." He goes on to say, "The open and free society that we enjoy is as fragile as it is precious. It relies on fundamental civil and political rights, not least of all, freedom of speech." Robert Majid, the publisher of the Australian Jewish News, wrote on the 15th of September 2016 in his publication, "The point about free speech, for which over centuries many have died, is the right to disagree. Bob Dylan sings, 'You're right from your side and I'm right from mine.' One man's bigot is another man's courageous defender of what many decent people think and feel. It is in the nature of satirists, comedians and cartoonists to exaggerate and very often offend. Inevitably, they end up being called bigots, as in the recent case of Bill Leake, one of the least bigoted people I know. Should these critics of society be looking over their shoulder to see whether the sheriff is about to take them on a perp walk? To them it is Section 18C which is intimidating. It is not only the legal definition that is in question, but the public perception that criticising behaviour of another people in a way that might insult and offend can lead to litigation." Dr. David Adler was a powerful witness before the Human Rights Committee. He's a member of the Sydney Jewish community, and he believes that Jewish communal organisations have not well reflected the diversity of opinion in his community. And he cited, in support of his evidence, other prominent Jews who feel the same way as he does, such as the lawyer Geoffrey Block, the former judge Jim Spiegelman, and the New South Wales Rabbinical Council, which has been concerned about this law and is in favour of changing it. He was writing in The Spectator Australia on the 11th of March this year, and he says, "What 18C does is to unreasonably constrain free speech in a manner inconsistent with Jewish theology, academic development and values. There is no evidence that Section 18C is an effective tool in changing a trend of anti-Semitism, in brackets there is much more effective tools, and such a law risks serious adverse consequences." There have also been a number of prominent Indigenous advocates of change, such as Warren Mundine, Anthony Dillon, Wesley Aird. But I want to quote two of these advocates of change because I think they've contributed very powerfully to this debate. Karen Foley, who's an Indigenous woman, was also writing in The Spectator Australia on the 26th of April 2014. And she said, "I hereby demand freedom from protection from the thing this thing we call racial vilification. I do not wish to be protected from the opinions of others. I demand the right to hear the views that other people may wish to express about me. I want this because I do not see how forcing others to shield their true opinion is of any benefit to me. Rather, it infantilises me by suggesting that I cannot handle the ugliness of life. Silencing or concealing the ugliness also exposes me to unnecessary risk. Since if all the others were free to express their views openly, I could at least make more informed choices about whom to associate with and whom to avoid." Jacinta Price, a councillor on the Alice Springs Council, wrote in The Australian on the 2nd of February this year, "The Racial Discrimination Act, Section 18C, treats us Aboriginal Australians as infants who can't speak up or stand up for ourselves. It treats non-Aboriginal people as if they have no right to hold an opinion about anything that relates to us, especially the problems of our own making that are killing us. The way to beat racism is through debate, not the closing down of debate." Another advocate of change is Irene Moss. She's a significant advocate of change for a number of reasons. Yes, she is a woman with Chinese heritage. She's also a former Race Discrimination Commissioner, and it was her inquiry in 1991 that in part led to the adoption of 18C and is often cited as a justification for the adoption of 18C. But Irene Moss doesn't agree. She believes that 18C is in need of reform. And in an interview with Chris Merritt from The Australian on the 6th of March this year, she said that, that the law adopted in 1994, quote, had ignored the inquiry's warnings that an offence which was drafted too broadly could lead to trivial complaints and confusion. The current controversy with respect to 18C was predictable, she said. She's in favour of a reform which removes offend, insult and humiliate from the law, which is strikingly similar to what the government has proposed. She says, in 1991, the report of the National Inquiry into Racist Violence recommended that legislation should not be about hurt feelings or injured sensibilities, but should focus on incitement to racial hostility. I continue to believe that that was essentially correct. Now, opponents in this debate might feel it is easy to dismiss my view or the view of Senator Smith or other colleagues in this place who don't meet the right demographic criteria according to them in order to have a right to participate in this debate. And they may disagree with people like Irene Moss and Warren Mundine and Anthony Dillon and Wesley Ed and Jacinta Price and Karen Foley and Gideon Rosner and Robert Majid and David Adler and Jeffrey Block and Jim Spiegelman, and they're entitled to. But they should at least have the decency to recognise the great diversity of thought and diversity of opinion within our ethnic communities. And I would encourage them to consider that around the world, limitations on free speech generally throughout history have been aimed at minority groups, not for their benefit, and have come at their great cost in many, many times throughout history. Freedom of speech and the liberal society in which we live and the ability to freely debate ideas and stand up for the things we believe in has always been the best guarantor of a tolerant and harmonious liberal society that we live in. It's what has helped Australia be as tolerant and harmonious and prosperous as it is today. It's what helps other countries around the world which share our values reflect that same tolerance and harmoniousness. And I believe that the government's bill will strike the right balance in ensuring we do have that free speech, that people, whatever their background, have the right to stand up and say what they believe and argue sincerely in favour of it, and that it remains unlawful to abuse someone on the basis of their race, as it should be.
Thank you, Senator Paterson.